Welcome back to the Leverage Podcast, where our goal is simple: to learn from the best and discover how we can all live a better life, build a more fruitful business, and be more productive. Join us each week as we interview fellow entrepreneurs, thought leaders, and leading experts to discuss everything from marketing secrets to new technology and life as an entrepreneur.
So on today's episode with Mark Winters, he is an amazing, amazing person. He's the co-author of Rocket Fuel. Mark is a friend. He's also a private client of mine, and he's just an amazing person. So this conversation goes really deep into the role of what they call in the EOS world, if you're familiar with EOS, what they call an integrator versus a visionary. And Mark is literally like, you know, him and Gino Wickman, who's coming up on the following episode coming out of Leverage. Those are the two real creators of these concepts. And as always, just a reminder, if you would like to watch the video of this recording, if you would like to see the comments and future live streams of these podcasts, we have the pop-up Facebook group called Making Remote Work Actually Work. So please come and join us in there. If you're on your computer, you could also go in your browser and go to remote.getleverage.com, and that will point you to the Facebook group. And we would really appreciate it if you like this episode. Give us a rating, subscribe on iTunes, write a comment. We really would appreciate that. So enjoy the episode. So welcome back to the Leverage Podcast. We have a very special guest. He's a personal friend of mine, past client. We haven't worked together in a while, and someone who's I'm a huge fan of, and that is Mark C. Winters, author, co-author of Rocket Fuel. So thank you, Mark, for joining us today.
Thank you, Nick, for having me. It's great to reconnect.
Yeah, no, it's been a while. I know that you've had quite the year, and we haven't caught up in a while. I mean, we were just chatting before this, so it's been great catching up.
Yeah.
I'm a huge fan of EOS, and we use it at our company. And there's some things that we've adapted, of course, and morphed. But I think overall, what you and Gino and the whole EOS community has done has been so instrumental for so many entrepreneurs. So I just want to start off by thanking you for kind of your contribution and all the impact that you've made for probably at this point, it's probably tens or hundreds of thousands of people.
Well, thank you. I'm a small part. There's, you know, 350 EOS implementers out there in the world, something like that. So I appreciate you saying that.
You are the co-author with Gino Wickman, who's going to be on the show in a couple of days.
Cool.
Coincidentally.
Cool.
He only does like a handful. Like I speak to you and him only like one, maybe once a year. And it just so happened that you're both, it's the EOS week this week with us. Would you mind just maybe briefly talking about EOS? What is an integrator, visionary? Why? How you came about these concepts? Why it's important? Because I think most people probably do know, but it's, you know, even if they do know, it's probably, you'll probably explain it in a way that people would find interesting. And if you don't, if you're one of the few that don't know, you should know this stuff.
Yeah. So let's start with EOS, I guess. So EOS stands for the Entrepreneurial Operating System, which was created by my good friend and co-author Gino Wickman, really out of the need that he had and the experience that he had in one of his businesses early on. And then, you know, it's been structured and formalized. And now, as I mentioned, really deployed through this community of now 350 plus professional EOS implementers that are all just super solid people. You know, they fit our core values. You know, they have, you know, the experience that helps you be really good at helping somebody else implement a system like this. And in a nutshell, Nick, you know, when you ask kind of, well, what is an operating system, you know, you talk about it in your model, right? I mean, you know, the ability to plan, I think your CPR model, right? The middle part is kind of where it shows up. And so that's what it's about. And we talk about it as a way to help, you know, an entrepreneurial leadership team really do three things that we'll describe as vision, traction, and healthy, where vision means that you really are crystal clear on where it is you're trying to go and how you plan to get there in a way that you can communicate to get your team, your whole organization really side to side, top to bottom, all 100% on the same page about what that looks like. Okay. Then traction means that every day when you wake up and you charge off into the real world, that real world that you encounter begins to look more and more like this picture of where you want to go. So you have this feeling of, hey, we're getting closer. That makes us feel like we're making progress. That progress gives us more confidence. That confidence gives us more energy to tackle the stuff that we need to tackle on our way to achieving that vision. And then finally, healthy is about the team. So when we're sitting here working as a team, you know, maybe the leadership team of the company, and we're looking across the, you know, the room or the table, or in this case, through the camera at each other, right? And seeing all these faces, we should have a really confident feeling. You know what? We really do have the right folks here to do the stuff that we need to get done. There's nothing we can't talk about. It's all just stuff. We're not afraid to bring things up. So we bring it up, we put it on the table, we talk it through, and then we use that stuff and figure out and decide how we're going to use it to help us get closer to this place that we've all said that we wanted to go. So the operating system EOS is all about helping a business make those three things become true. And it's a journey. And so that's the bigger structure. Any questions or other comments you want me to make on that?
Is there a particular size of business that this is particularly good for? Does this not work as well if you're a 1,000-person company, but works great if you're, you know, 10 to 50?
Yep. Great question. So really the sweet spot where it's been proven, time and time again, is really between 10 and 250 employee companies. So that's the size. The employee count is probably more relevant than the revenue, because it's reflective of the stage they're at in terms of really organizational complexity. You know, when you start to get to 10, it's not just the founder and a friend. You're starting to have to think about role specialization and who's going to do what. And the founder is typically ready to not be wearing all the hats anymore. And so they start to put together what we would consider a true leadership team. And that gets hard, right? So that's the challenges that EOS can really help you work through. Now that said, you know, that path from kind of 10 to 250 works like a dream in there. I've worked with many, many companies that are much smaller than that, and many, many that are much larger than that. And it also can be very effective there, but just want you to know that it's been proven, you know, most times in that kind of 10 to 250 part of the curve.
And I'll let you go on, but there's a lot of other frameworks, right, that people could use. So what would be some other frameworks? Might be OKRs. Would you consider that to be in the same?
Yeah, I don't know if I would consider that an operating system.
I guess it's like a goal set. I guess that's the equivalent of what your rock, rock portion of EOS, right?
Yeah.
Scaling up, would you consider that an operating system?
Probably. Yeah. I mean, there's, and I'm certainly not an expert in all the other ones, but yeah, there's lots of other operating systems out there. And an important note on that, Nick, is, you know, one of the things that's core to our belief is that, it's more important that you pick one operating system and become a master of it than which operating system you choose.
Yeah.
Right. So if you're going to try to, you know, take a little bit of this, a little bit of that, and just kind of, you know, knit together this hodgepodge of different things, that is going to be very problematic. You're going to create lots of complexity around language, because the word that means X in this system means Y in this system, and your people are just going to get confused. So, to help maximize your odds of success in what is a very difficult journey, implementing an operating system, you know, pick one and right, just commit to it, get everybody on board with it, be great at it. And that's really going to help you have the best chance of getting where you want to go.
If you could only pick one concept to take, like if EOS has many concepts, but if you were only allowed to take one concept and use it inside of your company, what do you feel is like the one concept that is more important than others?
Well, that's a really tough question, and I probably would beg off and give you two. So the first one is probably the concept of the accountability chart. Okay. So you just have to get crystal clear on what needs to be done, who's going to do it, and how is accountability for that stuff going to flow through the organization, right? So that I have...
This is an adapted version of an org chart, what you're calling an accountability chart?
It's an org chart without the downfalls. So the problem with org charts is they tend to be very hierarchical in the sense of, in more of an entitlement sense than a responsibility sense, right? So I'm on this level of the account, the org chart. So I must be, you know, more important, more valuable than somebody who's on that level of the org chart, which is, you know, rarely true, right? The other thing that they tend to get hung is the actual titles that go with it, and they lack clarity around what that position, that seat, as we'll call it, is really responsible for, really going to be held accountable for. So the accountability chart takes all the good stuff of that and says, all right, we're going to be crystal clear on what work needs to be done. We're going to group it in logical clumps that are kind of human-sized clumps so that we think a human can kind of get their arms and mind around this stuff. And it lays out, all right, here's what we're going to call them. So the leader of sales, we might call something really exotic, like, I don't know, sales leader, right? That really is indicative of what they do and what they're responsible for. And then we're going to draw that line of accountability. And so not, you know, a dotted line here, a solid line there, another dotted line over there that tends to get really confusing, but just a nice, dark, bold, dotted line of accountability that says, you know what, for these things, you are accountable to that person. And that's it. And so it just strips away all the entitlement stuff. It strips away all of the opportunities to get confused around who's doing what and who are they really, at the end of the day, accountable to for getting it done well.
Yeah. And what was the second one?
So the second one is all about clarity on where we're going and really how we're going to get there. Yeah. So the tool is called the Vision Traction Organizer, or VTO. And it has on it 8 questions that you've got to work through to answer that really gets you clear on, you know, on in one part, the vision, which is, you know, the way, different ways to think about and come at the question of where are we really going? And then the second part of it is really the plan for how we're going to get there. So what are the big priorities? So, you know, looking this year, for example, you know, what's the short list of things that we think if we get this stuff done, it's going to give us the most impact in terms of making progress towards that vision, getting us closer to where we're trying to go and set us up for the next level of success, along with some predictions really around what that's going to look like, you know, how much our numbers might move and what the whole picture might look like at the end of the year.
I'll tell Gino that you think his level 10 meeting concept sucks.
Yeah. you tell him that and see what reaction you get.
If I had to pick two, I think those would have been my two as well. Accountability, I geek out on tools, obviously, which you know that. I have some friends that built an org chart tool that you might find interesting. We were going to play around with it at Leverage. It's called sobol.io, S-O-B-O-L. But it's an org chart, but in circles of circles. So it looks like a Petri dish. So it's not hierarchical with this person reports to this person, but you form clusters.
Right.
So when you were saying like that clusters, I was saying, oh, you might like this. So this was built out of a company called Consensus, which is a blockchain company. So they're all about decentralization. So right. It's like a Petri dish, circle and spoke kind of org chart, but it's fairly interesting. But one thing that we started doing at Leverage, we go more the accountability chart route versus the traditional org chart. But what we started doing, especially last month with this whole coronavirus, is on an accountability chart, identifying the backup person to that role and responsibility. Yeah. So imagine like I'm accountable for sales. Who's the backup person in case that person's out?
Yeah. So, you know, we'll talk about that. And this isn't, you know, necessarily part of EOS, but it's certainly a topic that comes up as an issue for many, many of the leadership teams that we work with. And they'll think about it as succession planning. And there's just sort of a level of succession planning that's important. Just because you know, things happen, things change, whatever. So you got to be ready for that. But then there's also the bus factor succession. I don't know if you've heard that term before, but you know, if so and so were to get hit by a bus, what would we do?
Well, the coronavirus,
right? And say, yeah. So that's in vogue today. But you know, imagine that you've got a roster or a list of all these different seats on your accountability chart, and then you put, depending on how deep you want to go, a name. Or maybe a couple of names next to that seat. So I've got Joe in the seat right now. Next up would be Ben. And then Susan would be after Ben. And then you give some thought to level of readiness. Okay. And I've seen a red, yellow, green model used here to be pretty effective. So if you know, whoever I said the first one up if they're, they could hop in and we wouldn't miss a beat, then they're green, right? Maybe the next person in line is a yellow, and then maybe the next one is a red. So then you can kind of be proactive in terms of preparing those folks. But if you look down your list and first up on, you know, on deck for, you know, all the, that's any number of the key roles that you've got there is looking red, then, you know, that's obviously an issue. And it's also can be very powerful to push that getting your successor ready as an accountability to that individual. So if I'm trying to have a backup for Nick, guess who's accountable for there being somebody that's green in that box next to your seat? You are. And if you're not getting it done, then, you know, you're not living up to the things that we need you to be, you know, what we would call three yeses on your GWC for your seat.
It's totally aligned with what we are doing right now at Leverage. So I don't remember when I came out to Dallas to work with you, but if I told you this, but when I was a high frequency trader, we used to have to take a 2-week block leave every year to make sure we weren't hiding trades. Right, so right. I would have to document my processes, and every year I would have to have someone else take over. So aside from the fact that it's one, making sure that you're not doing something bad, it's de-risking the team so that if something happens, someone else is always, whenever I came back, even though I was the best person at that algorithm and I created it and all that, there was always an improvement to how my book traded because fresh eyes spark innovation, right? So I think that it's such a underappreciated activity to have backups and role rotation. So we've, every quarter when we do kind of our, every quarter when we identify the rocks that we want to achieve for the quarter, or OKRs, or whatever you want to, whatever people listening call their kind of quarterly goal setting, we always try to incorporate at least one role rotation where one role for a week rotates and you have someone else take it over.
Yeah.
And I think that right now with the coronavirus, everyone's been super stressed out for the last month. But I think that the big thing that I'm private clients of mine that I'm speaking to, I think the biggest thing that people aren't thinking about that's a huge risk is what happens if someone gets this thing and they're out for 2 weeks. I think that a lot of people haven't done this backup plan, succession planning, and they're sitting, especially right now. And that to me is the biggest risk in a lot of companies.
Yeah, no, I would agree that that's a substantial risk for those that haven't prepared for it. You know, unfortunately we're in a time right now where we're a lot of those gaps are getting exposed. You know, it's just stuff that we haven't thought about or we've put off. Because you know, there's more important stuff, right? And so we're getting bit by a lot of those.
Totally. I mean, the stuff that I teach, right? Setting up Slack or Asana or automating process. It's not how do you increase revenue and sell more stuff tomorrow. It's, you know, operational framework stuff. And same with documenting a process or role rotation. It's not going to directly increase your revenue, but that when the time comes where only one person knew how to do payroll and that person can't do it, you're going to wish you had, you know, been a little bit more proactive.
Yeah. So let me give you a thought on that. That's not as, it's not as dire as the, you know, the current crisis, but just a normal thing, right? So when we were together last year, you introduced me to Process Street and we started pushing a lot of stuff, towards that. And, you know, I had a member of my team that was planning to, you know, go on maternity leave. And so we knew that. And so, you know, through the rocks process, it became, you know, one of her rocks to basically, you know, identify these processes, get them documented, and then get them resourced appropriately so that Mark doesn't end up doing admin stuff, right? That was basically the gist of it, right? And it's worked great. So, you know, we're able to do that, able to bring in the new resources, get them trained up through a reference resource like Process Treat and make this stuff all work. You know, is it, do we catch 100% of everything? No, but we caught a lot. I mean, we caught, you know, probably in the 80s to 90s% of everything. So then the little things that you missed, it's not everything. It's not, you don't get thrown into crisis mode. The vast majority of stuff is working as it should. And then, you know, you can pick up the little crumbs that you might've missed and then roll on. So, you know, that is an example of where we here absolutely benefited from taking the time, making the investment to get out in front of something like that.
I'm glad that that stuck for you guys. Have you guys used Zapier with it, where you start automating steps in the process?
Yep. We're not as, you know, as highly developed in that. That may be the next thing that you work with us on. Yeah. So that's, you know, the next level is it's kind of a scaling move, right? Where we have a certain volume of things coming through and we haven't talked about it yet, but on the Rocket Fuel side in the Integrator Academy, we've got a certain volume of activity that's kind of flowing through the system right now. But with the things that we'll be introducing literally in the next couple of months, I expect that to take a big turn up in the curve. And so the volume of transactions going through is going to be significantly higher. And that's where all the automation things of hooking these things together so they can happen without human intervention, I think is going to really help us a lot as well.
Yeah. Let me know. There's so much, I mean, so much changes in even a 3 month period, no less like a year since we worked together. Right. But there's so much more functionality now in Process Tree where you have approvals and conditional logic. And not to mention, there's just, I'll figure out smarter ways of using some of these
things. Right.
Are you?
Yeah. Just real quick before we leave Process Tree. So actually, they've recently reached out, and I know that our integrator and at least somebody else from the team is doing kind of an audit with them. It's something that they, you know, they kind of go in and they kind of look at what's going on right now. And then kind of to your point, as the functionality has increased, there's things that we didn't even know were in there that it's capable of to kind of help us spot a bunch of that stuff.
Are they charging for the audit or is
that free? No, they're not. I figured that's just because I was your friend, right?
It's probably because you said you know me. it's a great tool. I have a few other new things that I can show you that I think you'd like. We used Notion for our knowledge base, which I don't think we were using before. Mm-hmm. So I've adapted a bit the CPR framework. So when I talk about documenting knowledge, I have a distinction between static and dynamic knowledge. So I classify Process Tree as dynamic knowledge, and then Notion does static. So static would be answering the question, who, what, when, where, why, who's the CEO, where's the office. So that's all knowledge, but it's not a process. Process answers the question, how do you onboard a new person in your integrator academy? How do you do payroll? Or it's a sequence of steps. It's all knowledge, but it's just two distinctions of classifications of knowledge.
Yeah, I love it. And in fact, it reminds me, so I used to, one of my businesses along the path was a very high-end analytics company. And we used to do forecasting and prediction models for, you know, large restaurant and retail chains all over the globe. And we used the concept of static and dynamic data. Right. So static data is it's here. Here's the address. They're this age or this gender or whatever. Actually, you know, arguably, you know, some of those can be dynamic. But, you know, the dynamic data is more the attitudinal stuff. It's more the transactional stuff. It's more the behavioral stuff of how you see them move through a marketplace. And we would deal with those in obviously very different ways and how we would incorporate them in our model, how we would collect that data, how we would manage that data. So that's a very clear way to think about the different types.
Yeah. It's subtle, but it's definitely distinct. And then we've been really successful. Do you use Asana? I don't remember which project management
tool. The team uses it more than me.
So like I was saying before, like I probably have doubled my productivity in the last year just by learning tweaks of how to use some of these tools. Asana being one of the main ones. Yeah. I thought I was good at it. And now I'm certified in it, et cetera. But I wasn't even scratching the surface of how to use that thing. If you use that tool, right? Like we're running all of our agendas, our L10 meetings in Asana.
Yeah.
It's great to run your L10 meetings in that tool. I know EOS has their own tool, but what I like about doing it there is you're already putting agenda items in your project management system of record. So any to-dos that come out of it, you're already in the tool.
Yeah. Yeah, I remember you showing me that, and I know that we have some other. There was a version that I've seen developed in Asana for doing exactly what you said. You know, then there's these other tools that are they're EOS pure, right? So traction tools and a system called 90. Those are all, they've been kind of checked out by EOS worldwide to make sure they're consistent with our process. But I understand what you're saying. There is a a niceness about being able to capture all of the action items right in the native thing that you use to manage projects and track all that stuff.
Well, it's always a trade-off between using a tool that's like specifically 100% built for a particular thing versus having too many tools, and you have to find that balance. Like people don't want 100 tools, but you can't have one tool do everything. So it's what's that sweet spot? Yeah. Another thing that we found with how we were running L10 meetings, we changed about 3 months ago, but we weren't documenting decisions made. So I don't know if in the traction tools, there's a place to document decisions made so you could go back and see 6 months ago what happened in a meeting.
Yeah. So, I mean, there is if it's relevant to the plan, right? So, but the decisions that happen outside of that that team or that plan or whatever, you know, those obviously don't get captured. That's more stuff that we would classify and categorize as business as usual stuff. So the business as usual stuff, yeah, a lot of that needs to happen in a system like Asana. And so the traction tools or 90 are really focused on, all right, what are our top priorities? What are the big issues that we're wrestling with that are, you know, in between us and getting that stuff done? And so it's really focused primarily on those.
Yeah. We started putting it in Notion, like the documenting of decisions, and that so far has been working out. We just realized that was a miss. It doesn't matter the tool, but just documenting, hey, this date we decided to not SEO tasks anymore at Leverage, you know?
So is that helping? Has that made you smarter, Nick? I mean, so talk to me about how you use that to learn and get better, get smarter.
Well, it definitely has helped in multiple ways. One way it's helped is there's so many decisions and so many moving parts that it's hard for me to remember. Oh, 3 months ago, that's when we decided to change the process where if a client doesn't respond to us in 24 hours, now we're moving it to 48 hours. Yeah. There's like so many of these detailed things that I would forget, and then my team would get frustrated with me. How come you don't remember that? I'm like, because it was like one of 10 million things that we had talked about in the last 3 months.
Yeah.
So that was a good way just to keep everyone kind of on the same page and not forget.
Do you go back and look at it though?
If I need to, I'm not looking at it regularly. But if someone says something, I'm like, I don't remember that. It only takes me it takes me less than a minute, and I can go and see what the company policy is.
Right.
I mean, at a high level, like what I talk about is a company can only scale as fast as knowledge can be transferred. So having a system where you can retrieve knowledge very quickly, whatever that type of knowledge is, could be communication, project status, et cetera.
Yeah.
But that's enough about me. I want to get back to Rocket Fuel EOS. So you wrote Rocket Fuel after Gino had already you wrote Rocket Fuel with Gino after Traction came out, right?
And, right. Yep.
And so I know the answer, but I'd love to hear your response. What's the difference? Why was there a need for the book Rocket Fuel after Traction?
So, all right. So let's go into, you know, you made me give my two favorite components of EOS. And one of them I said was the accountability chart, right? So the structure of the accountability chart includes two functions that we'll describe as the visionary and the integrator. Okay. So those are two distinct seats, two distinct roles, two distinct vital functions of the organization. So Gino had discovered this in his own life and experience, and actually named, particularly the integrator. So the visionary, people kind of talk about that, that wasn't something that really hadn't been out there before, but the integrator was something that had never been described quite like he started to describe it. And it matched my experience. So, you know, I had been in companies where I had somebody like that, and I'd been in companies where I didn't have somebody like that. And it was for me as a visionary much better when I had someone really good at that kind of stuff in that role. So he's like, hey, I'm thinking about writing a book. And so I sort of threw my hat in the ring for that project, and off we went. And so this has been, gosh, 6 years now, seven. I mean, I don't even remember exactly. It's a good while. Uh-huh. And so for those that don't really know what visionary integrator is about, think about the visionary as your typical, crazy entrepreneur that a lot of times is the founding entrepreneur, and they're running 1,000 miles a minute. They're coming up with new ideas all the time. They're seeing the future in a way that they're kind of looking down the road as, you know, where are things headed? Where do we need to be positioned so that we can take full advantage of that? They're often really good at big external relationships, strategic relationships, whether it's, folks in the community, folks in their vendor groups or in their industry circle, key collaborators that they may be working with. They're just really good at that kind of stuff. And then when they bring all that stuff unfiltered back to the organization, it just creates organizational overwhelm. I mean, it'll crush people. It'll confuse them. It'll freak them out. It'll burn them out. It'll do all that stuff. So imagine that all of that energy, all of that inspiration and insight comes into this function that we call the integrator function, that is filled by a person who has very different wiring than that visionary. So they're much more execution focused. They're much more about making it happen. They're much more about making it real and make it something that's predictable. And so they're particularly gifted at working through and between the different functions on the leadership team, whether it's sales and marketing or operations or finance and admin, whatever it might be, and kind of getting them all aligned so that they're pointed in the right direction or the same direction for where we're going. When they get stuck and start to have conflict, they can step in and really listen to everything that's being talked about and help us reach a conclusion. If that means them making the decision of what the best thing to do here is for the greater good of the company, they're great at helping knock down obstacles when they come up and help, get past that. And they are the best at accountability. So, crystal clear expectations for everybody on the leadership team, great communication, and then rock solid accountability to make sure that everybody is doing and following through on all the commitments that they've made, all the promises that they've made. So together, the visionary and the integrator, bringing in everything in from the outside and then getting it focused internally in the organization so it can happen and become real.
So what's the difference between a really solid project manager, the skill set of a project manager, and the skill set of an integrator? Is project management necessary but not sufficient to be an integrator?
Yeah, so I would say it's just a question of scale. So it rhymes, but the scale is bigger. And there's a sense of that here, right? So if I've got there's a matching process that we go through. We talk about the visionary and integrator as a two-piece puzzle that we're trying to fit together. So the visionary has a unique shape to the edge of their puzzle piece, and they're looking for an integrator that has a complementary distinct shape so that when we plug them together, they fit very nicely and there aren't gaps. So if, you and I are a visionary integrator duo and there's something that needs to happen, let's say it's be great at accountability and neither one of us is very good at that, then guess what? Together, we're probably not a great visionary integrator duo. Right? So between us, we got to have all the basics covered. And so to your question of a project manager, they may be able to have the individual skills. It's a question of, are they developed enough and mature enough that they can actually interface and interact with a visionary at the level they need to kind of stay on par with one another. If I've got a visionary that's a super hard charger and really driven and really out there, if I don't have a strong integrator that can basically lean back on them and kind of match up so that they don't get run over, then the visionary is just going to plow them over.
So what do you look at to know that it's a good fit, that the puzzle piece is fit? Do you look at Colby scores? Like, I know Colby has like team assessments and individual assessments. Is that something you suggest?
So great question. The first thing that we suggest is we've actually developed an instrument to assess their visionary tendencies and their integrator tendencies. So that's the first place I would go, is I would take the visionary integrator assessments.
Where do you find that assessment?
Is
that
on our website? Yeah, go to our website. So rocketfuelnow.com is the fastest path to get you to those assessments. And there's basically two numbers we're trying to get there. We're trying to get the visionary number. We're trying to get the integrator number. And the questions that they answer to address or result in each one of those numbers, what we want to do to assess a pair is basically take, if you and I are doing this, Nick, take your results and lay them on the table side by side with my results and look down them one line item at a time. And we're looking for two things. One, we're looking for, where do we have a gap? So if there's some item on the list that you're low at and I'm low at, that's a potential gap, right? And we just need to be aware of what that is, right?
It's scaling? What's the score, just so that people watching, is it like 1 to 5, 1 to 10?
Each item is scaled 1 to 5. Each item is scaled.
So what would be kind of the low? Like if both people were a 3 or a 2?
So one means I'm out. One means I don't have any affinity for that. Right. And 5 means, yeah, that's me. I'm all about that.
So if you're a 1 and I'm a 5, that's cool. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
probably. So here's where that gets a little bit tricky, is some of those questions are more traditional visionary and some are more traditional integrator. So if I'm a 1 and you're a 5, then what that should tell us is, you should probably be leading that. right? And so you just, it may be inconsistent with you know, what we would characterize as traditional for a visionary integrator. So we just got to be really clear on that. It's who's going to do what, who's going to take the lead and ultimately be accountable for this area of stuff.
Okay. So that's both. If both people are, say, below a three in a given category, that's the signal like, hey, we're going to have an issue here.
That's potentially a gap, right? So if we're both low, and, you know, depending on your business, depending on a lot of things, you know, three may be, you know, frighteningly low on some things. Three may be acceptably low on other things. So that's really dependent on the business and the pair and all that. But it's something you got to talk about. You know, one of the key disciplines of a visionary integrator relationship is staying on the same page. So this is a topic that the visionary integrator have got to work through so that they're 100% on the same page. They're crystal clear. You know what? We're strong in all these other areas. We're a little bit weak here. You're going to take the lead on it, and we're going to get some help through this other resource on our team or from outside or whatever to make sure that we, you know, don't, you know, step in a hole there. Okay. So we're looking, so you get a sense of the gap idea where our duo might be short in something. The other thing we look for is overlap. Okay. So if you're a five on something and I'm also a five on that, you got to realize that that may cause us to want to fight for the wheel, right? Because it's instinctively, I'm going to want to do it. Instinctively, you're going to want to do it. And it may not be a problem that we're both strong there. It again, just speaks to, we got to be crystal clear on who's driving, right? And you're going to drive that. We know that. We've made that decision. You know, I'm going to have thoughts and ideas and perspectives that may be helpful, but at the end of the day, you know, you're going to own that and be held accountable for it. And again, it just goes back to clarity and getting 100% on the same page.
Are you familiar with the Colby scoring?
Yep.
I think a lot of people listening probably have done Colby. So I changed by one number, but I think I'm a 7653.
7653. Okay.
So is that more, what's the typical profile in Colby for a visionary versus an integrator?
So we haven't found a typical in the Colby system. So again, I'm looking for match, and they've got some great tools to kind of help you assess match. But I would expect to see a visionary to be very high in, you want to guess which one?
Quick start,
right? Man, visionaries typically nines and tens. Again, it varies by business. And so it doesn't mean that if you're not that, you're not a visionary, but you know, if they're 9-10, you know, there's a good possibility of that. And then the other one is which one do you expect an integrator to be high in?
Follow through, probably.
Follow through, right? Because a lot of times, yeah, I've got a low follow through, high quick start visionary. And so they need somebody who is much higher than they are on follow through. They need, yeah, somebody who is high enough on quick start that they don't get totally frustrated with each other, right? They've got to be able to communicate and relate. And then same thing kind of on fact finder, right? They can't be so far apart on that that they just, you know, they just get totally frustrated by each other. That's a lot of that where it's matching. It's, and we've got to be able to, even though we're focused on very different things, we've got to be able to communicate in a similar context so that we can really kind of understand what each other's talking about. You know, you've got to be able to relate to me. I've got to be able to relate to you so I can understand what you want, what you're seeing, what you think's important, and then communicate the same stuff from my perspective.
That makes a ton of sense. So if I were looking to hire, say, an integrator, What kind of interview questions would you suggest I ask? What kind of background or skill set would I be looking for? Is there a type of, like, a profile that I should be looking for? Like, oh my God, this is what Mark said is the perfect integrator profile.
Yeah. So it's going to be dependent on you. And so we have, you know, in the book, we have a 7-step connection process. You know, we talk about this whole thing as being a journey where the first step is to really crystallize your understanding of the concept, because a lot of people have never heard of this before, right? So, okay, what is this visionary integrator stuff? How does that work? And then they make their own assessment of, is this something that can be useful for me, right? From the visionary's perspective or the integrator's perspective. Once they do that, you know, if I'm a visionary or I'm an integrator and I'm not paired up with my counterpart, then we go into the connection phase, right? So let me come back to the 7-step connection process. Just know that the phase after we do get connected, we call maximize, which is all about maximizing this relationship and taking that energy that each one has. which can, if left to its own, be very friction-filled, right? So they'll kind of butt heads a lot. And so we've got some structure, rules, and tools that we talk about to help blend that into something positive. That's really what the rocket fuel has. In the middle here, though, the connection phase, we got a 7-step connection process that's spelled out in the book. And the first 4 steps of that process are all about help me understand myself, help me understand my business, help me understand where I'm at in my own, you know, independent journey here as to how ready I am to get into a relationship like this, because it's a relationship. You know, this isn't just a hire that we make like any other hire that we make. You know, I have people that talk about this relationship as their business spouse. You know, I mean, that's how close we get. That's how much we communicate, right? That's how much trust ultimately we have to develop if we're going to get everything out of it. So the first phase of that is all about figuring out who you are and what's going on with you. And we're defining, you know, for the visionary first, the shape of that edge of their puzzle piece, right? What do I look like? What do I look like? Once I know that, then I can go to your question, which is, all right, to assess that, what kind of questions do I need to be asking that are going to help me best do that? Lots of great resources out there from these profiling companies. Colby, you've mentioned, Culture Index is another one. There are many. And all of those, I encourage people to tap into their expertise and use that to try to understand themselves and understand what they're looking for. Tailor their language, tailor their questions so that it's going to resonate with those people. Use their profiling system to give you an early indicator of, hey, this may be one of those patterns that I'm looking for. And there's actually some recruiters out there, Nick, that are starting to specialize their practice in integrator search.
Well, I was about to ask you, because is that something that you do or thinking about doing, since you already are launching running the Integrator Academy, you're training integrators. Could I go to you and say, hey, look, here's my profile. You've just worked with hundreds or thousands of people. Who do you got for me?
So that is exactly what I want to be able to do, but we're not there yet. So frankly, it's very manual right now to do that matching process. And so the side of the equation that we're working is really two things. So one, and you may remember from our earlier discussions, there's a shortage of integrators. They're the scarce commodity in the equation. Okay. So, you know, roughly 5% of the population is wired to be a visionary or an integrator. And of that, it's a 4-to-1 ratio of visionaries to integrators. Okay. So follow me on the math. So for 4 visionaries, there's 1 integrator just in raw numbers, but we talked about it being a 2-piece puzzle. This integrator's puzzle piece isn't going to fit with all 4 of those visionaries. So maybe they fit well with 2 of the 4, right? We don't know, something less than 4. So that's the math. So if you're a visionary and you don't have an integrator, my passionate plea to you is better go get it. You better start looking. You better get out in front, because they're the scarce commodity. And the other side of the equation is we're really trying to help identify and develop these integrator resources. That's what the Integrator Academy is really all about, because we've got lots of folks who have the raw material. They maybe just didn't know that an integrator was a thing. They've been doing this kind of stuff. They just didn't know that's what it was called. They didn't know that there was actually a role out there for them to really focus on that. So through the Integrator Academy, we're trying to identify these folks, bring them in, show them what it looks like to be a great integrator, and then train them up so that they can go and help some visionary.
Do you find that sometimes visionaries join the integrator program to get a better idea of what type of integrator they're looking for?
Yeah. So here's how we've seen that happen. It's really a program. The Integrator Academy Masterclass is really a program specifically for integrators. However, we'll occasionally have a visionary in there who is currently filling both roles themselves. So they're really wearing both hats right now. And what it helps them see is either, you know what, I actually like that integrator hat better, which has happened, or you know what, I really don't like that integrator hat. I do like this visionary hat. So now I'm crystal clear on what it is that I'm looking for. So it's not for somebody who's currently a visionary that has an integrator, but if it's somebody who's currently sitting in both seats, for them to get crystal clear and motivated to go make the move they need to fill that seat, then we do see that happen.
And if someone's interested in Integrator Academy, they go to rocketfuelnow.com.
rocketfuelnow.com, and that'll bring you in the, you know, really the front door to take the first step you need to start getting better.
And you also have Facebook groups and LinkedIn groups. I know you have Rocket Fuel Book Owners on LinkedIn, right?
Yep. There's a community on LinkedIn. Again, it's grown to be a pretty good sized community for anybody who's, you know, read the book or got the book Rocket Fuel. Go in there. And an interesting thing on your matching question is we actually do have people in that group that have found their counterpart just through the threads in that group. So they'll make a post like, "Hey, I'm an integrator looking for a visionary seeking an integrator."
I think I made a post in that group when I was looking for one, and I had a bunch of great applicants out of that.
Awesome. Love hearing that. Yeah. We've had some good matches made there. I know.
Yeah. We should talk, like, if there's anything I could be helpful with teaching the integrator system from a system standpoint, that could be interesting. Also, I might be helpful with the recruiting side of things. I have a friend building an HR tech platform for recruiting remote talent. But very cool. There might be opportunities to white label that and just make it and you have your own version just for integrators.
Interesting. Very cool. Very cool.
Let's talk about it, Marin. Nice. Yeah. All right, Mark. So if people want to find out more, where do they go? Rocketfuelnow.com, markcwinters.com. Is that right?
Those are the places. You know, for the most direct path to the Rocket Fuel stuff, go to rocketfuelnow.com. If you want kind of the bigger picture of all the other stuff that I'm working on too, then markcwinters.com will get you there.
Awesome.
We hope you enjoyed this episode of the Leverage Podcast from GetLeverage.com. Please let us know what you think. Rate and subscribe on iTunes. Leverage is an on-demand outsourcing platform that helps small business owners and entrepreneurs scale their business. We have experts that can help set up marketing and sales funnels, your email marketing, podcasts, social media creation, paid media, and much more. Grow your business overnight with a team of experts you can trust to deliver. Accomplish more. Visit GetLeverage.com.